I was asked to speak here at the Type 3 conference in English, and I said, okay, I'm sorry, my English is not the best. It's for me, it's okay, but for you, maybe it's not. Oh, okay, deal with it. Okay, let's start. Come in. Let's talk about responsive web design. Yeah, that's me. Thanks for the picture. Was it Jochen or who was it last year? My name is Sven. I'm doing the front-end stuff, HTML5, CSS3, and responsive, fancy stuff. Freelancer for agencies or some companies. And you see my hashtags, responsive web design, and sometimes a little party. Okay, let's start. Step back in history, 1993, the web is born. Yeah. It's wrong. First website in these days, yeah. You know it, maybe. The first website was responsive. No, not really responsive, but flexible. Yeah. Small screen. That are the native features of the web. Flexible by default, no pixel perfection, unknown browser features, yeah, many, many browsers, you don't know which browser supports what, maybe sometimes non-standard, the web has interactions, and you cannot control the flow of the content. Okay, but we moved further, the evolution in the mobile web, yeah. 2010, the client came to us, we need a mobile site. Okay, make a mobile site. Now, 2 years ago, okay, responsive is the new shit. Let's make it responsive. And now, maybe not as easy as everybody understand. This article from Ethan McCott, and about his way, his thoughts about the flexible and responsive web. He called this technique responsive web design. And you know it, maybe if you don't know the last article, maybe you know this article. This is the newer version, this is the redesign of Alyssa part, responsive web design, the basics, okay? What are the basics? You know, flexible grids, fluid images, and the media queries. We had flexible grids or flexible content before and flexible images as well. New to this deck was the media queries. Yeah. Now we can adapt the layout for a smaller screen. So, easy. We have a desktop site, and now make it responsive. Really easy. Okay, everything now on a small screen. Okay. Next try, easy. There is a responsive framework. Now bootstrap all the things, yeah. Cool too, maybe not. Okay. Yeah, maybe everybody thought mobile web, responsive web is easy. And if we had some projects with responsive, maybe you know it's not that easy sometimes. Okay, but responsive web design is cool. It solves many things, yeah. We have only one URL, only one code base, one deployment. Yeah, the content is available on every device, if not hidden, yeah, and true, it's future friendly for the next devices, for the next stuff. So how to start? Yeah, you saw it, we have a desktop site, okay. There is the thing mobile first, What's the difference? Mobile first, desktop first. Okay, if you start desktop first, imagine you have this shiny little responsive website, or this a theme, a template, and you put a shiny header image, this nice car, so big and shiny on desktop, and there are some other content and second content. So, and on mobile, you're shifting this. The car, the shiny car, is so little now. And the motorbike, the bicycle is so huge. Yeah, there are some problems, some content structure, some thoughts have to be before. Desktop first? No. Every time start mobile first. What's mobile first? Mobile first don't mean smartphone first. Yeah, sometimes designer came, yeah, how should I design for smartphone first? The client don't understand this, they want to see the huge desktop design. Mobile first doesn't mean smartphone first, but it is a good beginning, it's a good start. The main point is planning, conception and development with the focus on mobile devices. That's mobile first. And planning for touch, and you concentrate on the important content. Which content have to be in the first place? Technical? Go every time mobile first. Yeah, all devices gets the smartphone view, the smaller. Yeah, and then progressive enhancement, media queries from bottom up. Then go up, make a tablet version or tablet view or something like a desktop. What else? You have the chance to for new techniques, innovation, and you don't degrade the content. Yeah, we saw that. Yeah, you have the chance to enhance step by step. Some other technical steps you have to do. You have to change the border box model, but it's easy. Box sizing, border box, that's the start for every new responsive, for every new website. It's easier. And another thing is you have to put the meta viewport tag in the head so that the mobile browsers know, okay, that's mobile responsive site, and switch the views. So, some other things for the mobile first, use the new HTML5 input types. Yeah, it's easy, it provides some features for the mobile devices. You know it, you get the keyboards for the email type, an example. You have the what's the at sign in English? The at sign? Okay, maybe. And some other keyboards as well. For the telephone, you only get the numbers. And for date, you get the date picker. That is very useful for the mobile devices, and you can use it now. It has a decent fallback for all the browsers, yeah, and so why not use it? But be careful sometimes, yeah. The messages, yeah, don't disappear. Okay, what else? Think on touch. You have to embrace touch. Yeah, make everything touchable. There are some libraries, there's especially FastClick for faster touch interactions. Yeah, usually you have a delay on a click event handler. There's a 300 milliseconds delay with FastClick. Every click is faster. You start right now at the touch begin, also touch start. And it's a little library, a JavaScript library you can implement, integrate for the faster click events. So, but mobile first, and what's with content first? Another approach. Maybe you know it already. That's a little side, and this white box with this black characters, that's the content. The rest of the site is, yeah, Brad Frost called it bullshit. Yeah. Responsive content, if this device is smaller, it's more important to have the important content on on the top level at the beginning of the page. Imagine there are other ways to consume the content, RSS feeds, readability, Instapaper, and it has some advantage in SEO. And Google now displays a little icon if the website is mobile optimized, not only responsive. So mobile optimized websites and responsive website get a little icon in a search on a mobile device. So you know, okay, this site is best viewed. Design planning. So what can we say about the user's web? This is the old context. If we start a project and we plan, you can be sure your user uses the web like this. There's a fast internet connection, a big screen, maybe a capable browser. That was old. Now users go on the internet in every situation, on every place. Yeah, we now have internet overall. Not on every conference, but mostly. So in the different mobile context, yeah, you have this classical second screen here, yeah, watching TV, surfing on the web, and the other situations, I think you know it. Yeah. What's the mobile context? So everybody was told, yeah, mobile context, people are under rush. No, maybe that's the real mobile context, but we don't know. Okay, how do we plan for these situations? Nowadays, we don't know where the user visits our site. We don't know the screen size, we don't know browser capabilities, and we don't know the connection speed. We know nothing. Okay, maybe we have analytics and we have some key points and we can design for these key values. But in fact, we don't nothing about the user. On the other side, clients came to us and we need a new website, please make a design for a desktop and for iPhone. Yeah. Okay, 2 years ago, maybe that worked, but we had these different breakpoints. We have these viewports for the iPhone, yeah, 320 pixel, and maybe we make a design for an iPad view like this, okay, maybe three different designs, different layouts in Photoshop for the iPhone, for the iPad, and for the desktop. Yeah, but okay, what's maybe we can use the iPad as desktop version or vice versa. Nah, maybe someone user, we call it a framework. Not a responsive framework. And nowadays, we have some more breakpoints. Yeah, these old Androids. Most of the Android devices have a viewport in portrait modus from 360 pixel. What is about smaller tablets? Should we do a screen design for smaller tablets as well? What about the larger screens or the TVs? Yeah, huge TVs. Special design? We don't know. Ah, then some devices came out, okay. A mega tablet from Toshiba. 1060 pixel and yeah, clear. New iPhone and iPhone 6 Plus. New device sizes, new designs for every device, for every device class. Some devices are a little bit bigger. Here's a UI. There's a 480 pixels viewport portrait modus. So it's very huge for a smartphone. And this week, a press, came out. Press, the HP Slate 17. It's an Android tablet which will come out this November and has a display of 1920 by 1080 pixel. That's full HD. But we don't know what the viewport is. Maybe the viewport is exactly 1920 pixel. Maybe it's smaller. But yeah, there is a huge tablet and a huge touchable device. And here are a few Android devices. Maybe you saw that picture. That's nearly all Android devices with the sales numbers. Samsung Galaxy and all. Maybe you find your device. That's huge area of Android devices. And not only the different screen sizes, it makes a difference between desktop pixel and device pixel. You see here the desktop on the left and the iPad mini on the right. They are both at 1024 pixels wide, but the iPad mini is much smaller, so the fonts are much smaller. Same device, same pixels, but different sizes. So don't decide the breakpoints on devices, decide on the content. Take a seat. So, and then we are in this part where we have to overthink the workflow. Daniel Moll had a great talk at the BT Conf this year, and he showed how it is possible to come from the old waterfall workflow to an agile workflow in only 6 simple steps. Imagine, and you know it from maybe from your agency, like this is the old approach. We make a concept, user experience design. Then the next step is we make the design. Screen designer make some different screen designs, and if this is finished, we start to development. That's a little bit a problem. But we can make it better. If you want to make it more agile, you can overlap these lanes a bit. And if we plan more time together, then overlapping these columns more. And maybe as a next step, you can the maximum the involvement of everybody. So the developer starts right at the beginning together with your designer and your concept user experience designer, and everybody had the same start, the same knowledge about the project. Okay, it's clear you can't work all together. You have to at the beginning a little more, and then cluster it a little bit. So at the kickoff, at the beginning, you are working together, but for sure in different directions. Developers make a little mock-up and testing, and the designers and conceptor, they're making some scribbles for the modules and so on. And in the end, if you launch the project, you will come together and checking if everything is okay and have a successful project. And this scenario you can make smaller and smaller time changes and repeat it. And so we have the so-called Scrum process for little modules, and do it again and again. And so it's more the agile way, and so it's more can be a better project for everyone. So try to do an iterative way, and try to test early and make prototypes and so on. So new sign-offs for clients could be style guides and prototypes, and concentrate on the performance and what should the browser support be. And maybe not in general. What is the browser support in general? Maybe you define the browser support for different components. Some components have to be work in older browsers, some are not. And what about the responsive image strategy? So this left from this. I have some slides from yesterday, and if you are interested in the workflow, you can read some more. So we're going more into the technical parts now. So grids are easy. You can have grids, simple grids, and there are many grid systems out there. And now I want to show you some of the approaches, some of the techniques. So let's see how this works. A simple product view grid. So that's a simple grid system, only for the pro something like a product view. It's not a real system, but I want to show how easy you can have some grid views. That's a simple list with items there, and so you can have easily some grids, and they work all together. But that's easy, They were not responsive, you say? Yeah, that's true. They're only flexible. Next example. Oops. This link. That's similar. You have some columns, So now the boxes are somewhat responsive. Yeah. Small view boxes are in one column, and then you have two columns, three columns, and so on. It's nothing more than a display inline block on the columns, on the single items, and a width of 200 pixels. So if there is enough space, the boxes rearrange. Simple. Next. Wrong link. Similar example, but now, yeah, you can call it fully responsive. You see, the boxes are flexible, but on a different viewport, there are space for more boxes. So this is also easy, but you see, this is more the responsive way. Yeah, we have a media query, and you switches how many items fit into this viewport. Yeah, you're setting the width, and so more or less items fit on the screen. This is the more responsive way. And now we have this new shiny CSS feature called Flexbox. And I'll show you the code. You see the grid is the same. Yeah, see no media queries, no hidden stuff. And now you can see it's similar to this first example, yeah, but more flexible. It's only with this new feature of Flexbox, display flex, and with the addition how to wrap these items, how to arrange these items. And there is a property called flex wrap, and if I comment this out, this is the normal behavior of the flex box. You have all the items in one line, and now with flex wrap we can say, okay, wrap these items, yeah, and fill the space. We have here for each column 250 pixels. That's the width, and you see it. Yeah, they're not really flexible, but in a way. So, last example, and now we can go one step ahead, and you will, maybe you will see nearly the same elements. I have the grids from 1 to 12, and this is the CSS. And I will comment it out. So that's the usual grid as we see it before, and it's flexible, as you know. Yeah, and simple ordering. You can say the last child should be on the first place. Yeah. Flexbox orders these items, and you see the last child is now on the first place. So the last example of this. You can have, is this the right? You can have a simple ordering with CSS. Yeah, flexible, as we saw it. Yeah. And now, here, I change the order with CSS. So that's easy now these days with CSS. Changing the order, and it's possible with Flexbox. Yeah, this is the usual one, the Flexbox wrap, and now I set it to reverse and can wrap reverse these items, and for sure rows too. That's a simple CSS sorting. Okay, cool. But for sure there are some advanced stuff, some advanced grid systems. That was only a simple example how the web is flexible for now. And if you want a better grid system and you use SAS, I recommend you the Singularity grid system. You can define your own grids. You don't have to rely on anything. You are independent from the HTML. You can all define in CSS and SAS. And you can make all the grids you can imagine. You can have asymmetric grids and responsive grids, grids that changes from 3 columns to 6 columns to 12 columns. Yeah, all is possible without touching the markup, all with CSS and the grid system. Yeah. Other possibilities are the column layouts, some of the Pinterest view. Oh, easy with column layout. You can change the columns from 4 to 3, prefixes. The rearrange, not so good. Now you see nothing special, only the items and the text. Easily done with the CSS3 column property. Well, the easy part, making some boxes responsive. But responsive web design is more. And I think, as you have seen this presentation for Robert Frost, you've seen this slide. This is the responsive web design iceberg.
And the Lord has made it. It's an iceberg.
On the top, that's the tip of the iceberg.
This is responsive web design as we use, you know it.
But
in reality there's more.
There comes
content strategy,
conditional loading,
performance,
maintenance,
topic in responsive web design.
You have
other
things to
image, a headline, line, text.
And now,
if you are smaller, you can switch the image and the headline easily with FlexFox. Same as before, the display flex option. And if the viewport is smaller, otherwise around, if the viewport is larger than 600 pixels, we switch the order from the headline and the image. You see, headline is first, image is second. And with Flexbox, you can switch it. Yeah. Slides are online, you can try it on your own later on. And it's possible with a fallback for older browsers. Same example, headline above the image, headline under the image. And this is possible in older browsers too. Yeah, you see, headline, image, and we use an older property, we use the table footer group property here for display. And so you can switch the order above and down the image. That works in older browsers too, IE8 and so on. Simple order switching of content. So close some tabs here. Other things, adaptive maps. That's you can look at this example for yourself. This is a simple example. We use on smaller devices only the static version of Google Maps. You load a static image. For sure, it's much smaller. And if the viewport is large enough, you can load the full-featured Google Maps card in an iframe, and so you have an adaptive map. And for smaller devices, is you load fewer content, fewer JavaScript. Only the image is loaded, and it saves bandwidth and traffic. So other things, responsive table is always an important topic if you have legacy content. This is another example. Imagine you have this huge table here with different names. You see, I show you the table. This is a normal table, like a real table, not in a div table. And if this switches to a smaller viewport, the table columns switched. I'm gonna show you the CSS. You set the rows and the cells to block, and nothing special here. The only special is we use an attribute for the content. That's the data label attribute that we set on our content. You see, this is the label for every column, and this comes before the real content as an pseudo element before. And now you can read this table on your small device and it's legible. Yeah, sometimes you have to adjust the third-party widgets. That's a small example. If the third-party widget has a fixed width, you can set it with CSS.
like the images. So, another topic, navigation. It's always fun, yeah? This is an example of an responsive navigation. Huge. Okay, it works. We see all the navigation items, but really useful. But is it? It isn't. Some other examples I used. This is a small overflow tab navigation. So, yeah. You see how it was before. And if the viewport is smaller, you have a little overflow scrolling here. On the device, there isn't a scroll bar. Yeah, you don't have scroll bars, and you can easily touch and move this little content navigation. Yeah. Simple example, and another simple example, another content navigation. Imagine you have different items. Some text are smaller, some are larger, and at some breakpoint they should switch the order, and now they are have a another display property, the display table. And display table, there you have the chance to vertical align the text. Like an older table, you can set vertical align to middle, and the text is always in the middle. Simple example for a content navigation. For a client, we had to do multi-level responsive navigation. That was more difficult. This is the how it should look like, and I can open it. This is the website for now. We launched last week, and on a desktop side, this is the usual flyout navigation. And on a smaller device, you get the burger menu. That was easy. Two levels, and then the client said, okay, we need three levels, and no, we need four levels, maybe we need, and that's the pain. Okay, it worked. Maybe it's not the best looking, but in the end it worked. I posted it. If you have to estimate this effort, think of the levels and multiply it. It's not so easy, this responsive, and a lot of work. If it's possible, strip down the navigation items, the structure, and think again what is the right navigation approach, what is the right content structure. So far so good. There are some problems and some goodies in the typography of the responsive web. Always set the text size adjust to 100%. Yeah. The usual behavior is when you switch the orientation of the device on a WebKit on an iPhone device, the font size will not other way, the font size changes. Yeah, it is larger on an orientation landscape. So if you don't want this, you have to set text size adjust to 100%. Then the font size is always the same in every orientation. Another tip is set the font size of every input field or select the text area field to 16 pixels. Then you prevent the page zooming. If you focus an input field and the text size is under 16 pixels, the site zooms a little bit. Yeah, maybe you have seen it. And some other stuff here in the presentation about typography. The advantage for responsive web design is we can use the EM, the relative value here. Easily you can switch the overall font size for the different viewports, and now new property from the values is the REM font value, and this value based on the root element on the HTML. Yeah, if you set somewhere in your CSS the font size to 1 REM, it will always refer to the HTML. This is different to the EM. EM will always refer to the parent element. Yeah. So you can set 1 REM and this will always be 16 pixels if you don't change the root value, the HTML font size. Usually this is 100%, and in the most common browsers it is 16 pixel, but there are some browsers they have higher default values. The UC browser is a common browser in the Asian market. They have 19 pixel default. Yeah, if you want to be sure that the font the root size is always 16 pixel, set 16 pixel to the HTML. This can easily be done with an sass function. You can use it like this. It's a small function that has a default value for the font size. Yeah, you set here 16 pixel, that is your default, and you use it like this for the H1 headline. It is font size REM, that's the function in sass function call, and 24 pics. Yeah, you want 24 pics and you get 1.5 REM. For older browsers you get the 24 pics that you entered. Yeah, you see here's a little condition. If oldie is true, that's for the old IE browsers, they get a separate CSS style from my sass, and they will get the pixel value, and all other modern browsers get the REM value. And there's a more advanced sass REM mixin, they can do a little bit more. Some other new values. Now we have viewport relative units. Yeah, we can have font size based on the viewport. Look at this worked here. Sie, das Font da heißt, ist 4VW. And if I bless you. You see, the font size adapt to the screen size. This is easily use of this. Yeah, you see, 1VW is 1% of the viewport, and VH is 1% of the viewport height, and so on and so on. A great use case is for full width images in your sites. So you see, this is a normal text, and this has article container, and in this text we have a image and a little wrapper class full width, and further text. So, and now with a little bit help and a little bit help of sus, no sus included, but it works without sus. So, and it's a little bit small, maybe. So, and full this image from inside your container. Easily, with a little bit help of CSS. And see, full width is 100VW, the full container, the full viewport width, not the container, the viewport width. And you can position it. You have to translate it a little bit. I'll switch it off. You see, the start is usually at the container left side, and with translate you can shift the start to the beginning of the screen without position absolute, and so on and so on. That's a great use case for the VW value. But as a little hint, viewport values are a little bit buggy at the moment. iOS 7 is a little bit buggy, and older Chrome versions. In newer iOS version 8 and newer Chrome version, it worked as expected. What else? Web fonts. Come in. Web fonts are great, yeah, but we have to be careful how we use the web fonts. You see a little screenshot. Do you see it? This is the wrong bold. This is a so-called faux bold. The text is not the real bold font. It is interpolated from the browser. What's the interpolarisiert? Huh? Interpolated? You know what I mean. And another problem is the font loading performance. Do you see such screens on your go? You're waiting and waiting and waiting for a content, and nothing happened. Maybe sometimes you have the luck, fallback font appears, and you have to wait for the web font to load. That's a problem, and you can do it better. You can use the web font loader, a little script from TypeKit. It is used by Google, FontDeck, and you can use your fonts.com fonts, and you can use it for your self-hosted fonts. Fonts were loaded async, and that is much better experience. So you have some font loading event classes. Yeah, the script sets some classes in your HTML root. You have the WF loading and active and inactive, and you can have the special classes for every font family name. So you set the fallback on the headlines font family sans serif, and you set the web font only if the web font is active, the WF active class. Only then you you set the web font to this text. You have a little flash of content, but that's a better experience than waiting for all these fonts. Now we have icon fonts, or not, but usually we have icon fonts. Sometimes they fail, the fonts are not loaded, and you can read the normal font characters, and that's not so good. Icon font fallback is a little bit hard, and there are some great libraries out there. There's the Font Awesome library with more than 400 icons. If you use this library as it is provided, you have to download 22k of CSS, and the font himself with 65k or 112k for an Android, an older Android device. This is the TTF font. This is loaded on an older Android device. And newer devices can load the WoW format, and it's a little bit smaller than, but it is very, very huge for only a few icons. If you don't use all the 479 icons. Yes, this WoW, the WoW format, yes. For older Android devices, you need to include the TTF file format, and for if you want to support the older IE browsers, you have to include the EOT file as well. Yeah, it's for the dusty old iOS 4 devices. Right, you have to choose what is your support. If you don't care about the old IE, you can skip the EOT file, or load the EOT file only in conditional comments and so on. The modern browsers choose the appropriate file if they see more than one declaration. Yeah, the next step of the WoW file is the WoW2. It's furthermore compressed of the WoW. It's even smaller than the WoW file now, but it's not widely supported. It's now in Chrome, and globally that's it. Yeah. Okay, but for only a few icons, loading a whole library is stupid. Yeah, there is the great service iCommun, and there you can load your icons, only the icons you want to use, or you want, yeah, only the icons you need. Do you know iCommun? Who knows? Well, yeah. You know, you can select your icons, only the icons you use on your website. This is an example of the font Awesome. You have to add the library to the service. Then you can choose these icons to use. I use example these three icons. Yeah. And on next page, I can download my set of icons, my custom set, and you see it is much smaller. Maybe on the last row is 1 kilobyte, only 1 kilobyte and 789 bytes CSS, much smaller than the whole Font Awesome library. Yeah. And you can add further icons if you want. If you start with 3 icons and now you need an arrow or something else, you can add to this and download it again. And you can upload own icons. If you don't find an icon in these libraries, you can create your own SVG icon, upload it, and add it to the library and download your own icon font. Much smaller than a whole library. Slides are online. Yeah, and then we go a step further. Icon fonts was yesterday, now we have SVG icon sprites. SVG is great. You can have the similar icons and instead of the icon fonts. Do you know SVG? SVG. The older days, SVG is there since 1999. Yeah. And now we can use it finally in the modern browsers. SVG is scalable vector graphics. It's great for logos and icons. You see the same source and different width. Yeah, you see, this is an example, sharp in all dimensions. And we can go further. Responsive SVG logo. Yeah. Sounds a little bit crazy, but it is possible. It's oh yeah, here. Okay. That's my great design. My SVG logo. And in the SVG you can set CSS styling. I open the example. This is the logo. And if the works great. Okay, what should happen? I'll work it on a separate stage. No? Okay, what should happen? The text under my logo should disappear. The breakpoint is too small, but you can see it. Yeah, makes it 280. It's not the best example if I show you the whole site. If I put the logo in a container, then it is better. But you can use CSS in your SVG, and you can display some stuff of the SVG, or you hide some stuff of the SVG if the text is too small. Yeah. And what you can also do, you can have print as media queries. Yeah. Yeah, not as expected, but you can maybe can see it a little bit. What's this here? So you can see the logo is now black and white if you want to print it. In the SVG, I said if you want print, media print, my logo has another fill color and is black. And the other part of the logo is filled with white, and there's a stroke outside now in black, and the stroke width is 2 point. Can show you this on the if I remove the print here. You see, this is the print logo. I can change the stroke width. This is SVG, and you can do it with CSS from outside if you include the SVG as native SVG. That's great with SVG. So, and so you can have responsive logos, and you can have animations inside an SVG. There's nothing than an SVG, no CSS, no JavaScript animations, only SVG. Yeah, what's the time? Yeah, responsive images is a topic for itself. Yeah, you know, responsive images, images are the majority of the average web page now. It is in an average of the 1,000 websites of 1.2 megabytes. Every site in an average loads 1.2 megabyte images, and it grows. You see here it was nearly 500 kilobytes, now it's over 1 megabyte. That's huge, and you can save a lot of kilobytes if you provide the right image size for the right device. This little table can see the if you have a full width image on a MacBook Retina, you have nearly 172 kilobyte compressed image size. That is uncompressed 5.3 megabyte on the graphical level. You see, smaller devices, a full size image is much smaller. Yeah, for an usual iPhone and an iPhone 4, it is 22 kilobyte, yeah, on only 0.37 megabyte of data in a graphic RAM. So we need a responsive image solution, and now after 3 years we have a standardized solution. We have now picture, sourced and sizes finally. If you only want resolution switching, you only have to use the source set and the sizes. This is the markup. Now you have the image, You see, here the source is the smallest version as fallback for older browsers. And now we have a new attribute, the source set attribute, where you can define several assets, yeah, the large, medium, small as an example. And we have sizes, and sizes now define how large these images are shown. It's a little bit complicated and needs another hour to explain. But maybe I can show you a little example. Yeah, we go back to the small phone view. This is smaller than 320, and now we have the next resolution. And this is the markup for now. Here's nothing fancy, the example from before. Now you can see the resolution switching. The browser now cares which is the right image to show. And this works now in Chrome, in the latest version. But there are another use case, that's the image art direction use case. Here, this is only if you want to provide smaller images of the same image. And then another approach is the direct art direction use case. Yeah, if the image is too small or to want to show another image, not the same image, then we can use the picture. And this is a little example and a hidden gem in the responsive web design article. They have responsive images and art-directed images as well. Yeah, that's a little gem in the article, responsive images. So, yeah, as I said, we can now use it in Chrome, in the latest Chrome, and Firefox will get it with the next version, and Safari with the Yosemite update. For the other browsers, we have to use the picture fill, polyfill, and you can use the markup for now, and picture fill will provide the right image for the other browsers. So what's left? Responsive iframe. You always know if you want to integrate a video from YouTube, yeah, you have the fixed iframe and how to make this one responsive. So that's easy. You set the max width to 100%. Same with the image, yeah. And you need a fluid container. You need a container where the iframe is in the container, and then a little bit of CSS. You have to position the embed, responsive embed container relative, and give a padding to the bottom by 56%. That's the ratio 16:9. And the iframe is positioned absolute and the corner top left, and it's 100% wide and height. And you can do this with other iframes too. Here's a Flickr example. Yeah, you see, this is the container, and this is the page container. This is the responsive container. That's the iframe from Flickr, and this has another padding. The padding top is 75. That is 4x3 ratio. So, and now the container is responsive and the iframe is responsive too. Here we have a maxvis to the page container. So we can make the iframes responsive. To be clear, the content of the iframe has to be responsive itself. Yeah. So, oh, it's time. Some words about the performance. Okay, you know, responsive is easy. Everybody makes a responsive website. Ah, Walter Oakley did a little bit too much. This site has had 85.4 megabyte, 471 HTTP requests. It loads. It has a loading screen over 2 minutes, and till everything is loaded, there were 4 minutes and 10 seconds. This is not responsive web design. Please care about the loading and the request. Okay, now it's better. There are only 14 megabyte, but 291 requests left. They saved more than 70 megabyte on the index on the start page. 70 megabyte on images, on videos, on what else. The mobile site with the mobile agent is a little bit better, but 6 megabyte and 114 requests are too much. Okay, we know responsive web design has some issues. They tend to be a little bit too large. Yeah, sometimes content is hard to adapt. The images, tables, ads, a little bit hard for all views. And we have to deal with the Internet Explorer 8 sometimes. Yeah, we are not there yet. Okay, but we do better now. Guy Pajani makes some tests, and in 2012 and 2013, and the results from 2013 were better, but we can do better. Yeah, performance is our biggest issue. Yeah, we have to care about it. We have to try to reduce the image payload and reduce the JavaScript and CSS, and try to optimize on the features. So take care if you insert third-party scripts, and if you insert, as example, the Facebook like button and the YouTube video, you inserted 1 megabyte. Yeah, the JavaScript of the YouTube video is 785 kilobytes. That much for mobile device on. Yeah. Other third-party scripts are big as well. The Google Maps are 700k, and some other tracking scripts are, yeah, not so big, but 80 kilobyte for tracking or 60 kilobyte for tracking. Maybe you have to overthink it. Okay, some tips. So use the best image size for every breakpoint. Yeah, you see responsive images can be done now. Use gzip and caching. Avoid redirecting unnecessary DNS requests, or try to prefetch the request. Compress your CSS and JavaScript concatenate to useful chunks, not concatenate all useful chunks, and load asynchronously after the DOM content loaded, if you don't have to rely on load. And try to modularize JavaScript using script loader like require.js, and the best way is to optimize for the critical path rendering, but that's the I point. So there, see, we can do a little technical stuff, some hot shit, and we can do it better with our workflow. But as Rick said here, the biggest challenge in responsive design is not technical nor visual. It is making your client to understand what the web is actually about. Understand the client what we are doing. That's the hard part. And yeah, I think now everybody is happy. Then responsive web design is a lot of fun. Thank you for your attention.